First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
Peace. Once again, we back. And today's class is you're going to be speaking on the Washington Moors, MSTA, and the Islamic connection. First, let's break down Islam. That's the first thing. It is not a religion in which that just started 1,400 years ago with a so-called Arab by the name of Muhammad, because Muhammad actually was not the name of the individual. If you go to any of the hadiths, you will find out that his name was Ahmed. So the word or the name Muhammad was taken on, and that is an ancient Kemetic or Temerian or Kemetic name. Mu, water, ham, black, mad, justice. All right, the waters of black justice. All right, that's what that is symbolic to. So Muhammad symbolizes actually a form of Hapi, who was the River Nile god, or Netter, or deity, all right? And the River Nile god, Hapi, bought Serem. The word Serem is where you get the origin of the word Selam. The R's and the L's are interchangeable in the ancient Kemetic script, or what is called Metuneter. So Hapi, we also get the word happy from, bought peace, salam, serem, which also means sanctuary, as in the temple of the Most High God, which is actually referring to your physical body. All right? So, in other words, you're supposed to find inner peace. And by you finding inner peace, it projects outward as a manifestation of peace into the world. So, this is the actual origin of this information. If you read Gerald Massey's lectures by Gerald Massey, the Ancient Light of the Ancient Egypt, the Light of the World by Gerald Massey, the Book of Beginnings by Gerald Massey, his other books about Genesis, you will find this information correlated within the text whenever it comes up about Hapi. So Muhammad took or Ahmed took the name Mohammed, in which that was a reference to the deity or the Netter Hapi, all right, which was his title, Muhammad. All right? So let's get away from idolizing allegedly the man, the flesh, and let's get into the principles in which that was taught, the concepts from where they actually originated, the source of this information. All right? So when we speak about Islam, we're talking about actually the ancient mystery school system, particularly under the branch of Mayat. It was her school of thought of the virtues, the cardinal virtues. Hence the science of now within the Moorish Science Temple of America, the Moorish Holy Temple of Science, Moorish Holy Temple of Science of the World, which is all full up under the Moorish Divine and National Movement, the civic side, as well as also the religious side, with brought love, true peace, freedom, and justice. Those are the virtues, the cardinal virtues and the principles or laws of Mayat. That's why pre-Arabian times, the deity in which that was worshipped was Alat, which is a form of Amen Rayat, which becomes Amenta in ancient Kemet. Her counterpart is Amen Ra. Hence the reason why within all three monotheistic belief systems, Christianity, Islam, Judaism, we say at the end of the prayers, Amen. Symbolic to you tapping into that hidden force within you. The hidden force within you is the divine soul, the higher self, the God portion of yourself, which is embedded within the pineal gland. It is called the sleeping God. In order for the sleeping God to be resurrected, it must come through the mother principle, the mother goddess, the queen of the heavens, Aset. Aset is symbolic to the Kundalini energy, the serpentine fire that rests at the base of the spine. And as she is awakened herself, as she becomes awoke, she's wrapped 3.5 times koyu at the base of the spine, and as she becomes awoke, she raises through those various chakras, collecting the conscious information in which that is buried within each and every one of them, which is called your endocrine glands or your hormonal or chemical glands within your body, in which that helps with keeping hormonal balance in your body. She takes all that information as she comes up to bestow it and to give forth to Asar, which is the sleeping soul. And as they merge, their merger, which is divine marriage in heaven, the Bible speaks of it as the bride and the bridegroom. The bride is Aset, which is the Kundalini, also referred to as Shekinah within the Hebrew. Within the ancient Kemetic text or Tamarian text, Egyptian text, whatever term that you want to refer to it as, she's known as Sekhmet. All right? Which is the raw, unadulterated force of Ra. All right? And so, as she awakens, Asar, the Rip Van Winkle within you. Hence, Winkle is symbolic to the eye wink. In other words, opening activation of the third eye. So as she rips open the Rip Van Winkle, you get it? Rip open the eye. He awakens from his slumber, the sleeping giant, the Nephilim, the genie in a bottle, hence Aladdin's lamp. When you rub Aladdin's lamp, Aladdin means Allah's path, or Allah's way, or Allah's religion. The word religion comes from the Latin word religo, which means to bind back or to hold back. What it's talking about is the union between the lower self and higher self. The lower self merging into the higher self. That's religion. All right? That is what is called in ancient Kemetic times, or let's first, the Sanskrit, they refer to it as yog or yoga, the union, coming from Samatawi, which is the ancient Kemetic term of this union of lower self and higher self. On the walls of ancient Temeria, Kemet, Egypt, you would see Heru and Set tying together by the Djigid. The Djigid is the backbone of Osiris, which is talking about the spinal column, that when they merge, it must be done so through Osar, the backbone of Osiris. All right, so it must be done through those 33 vertebrates. Hence the reason why within Masonry, they have 33 degrees. Hence the reason why within your Bible, it says that Jesus died at the age of 33. Hence the reason why they say Alexander the so-called great died at the age of 33. Hence the reason why from Adam to David is 33 generations, and then from David to Jesus is 33 generations. Hence the reason why there's 66 books in your Bible. Because there's 33 vertebrates and then 33 nerves. 31 inside of the spinal column, two nerves that crisscross each other outside called the ida and the pingala, or what is called the sacral nerves in English. So 31 plus 2 is 33. So the book of life is actually talking about your physical body, your genealogy. Hence the reason why it starts in the Bible first with Genesis, your genes, and then ends with the book of Revelations, which means to reveal what was that, what was what, encoded inside your genes. Stop the bullshit. It's a book in order for you to open up yourself. That's why it's seven churches, symbolic to the seven churches, symbolic to the seven chakras, I should say, which must be open, that must be revealed, unsealed. This is what this is all symbolic to. And it has everything to do with the term Washita, because many don't know what the word Washita actually originated from. All right, the word Washita or Oshita means the father and mother of the mystics. All right? It is an indigenous Nagal or Mu transliteration of the pronunciation of Washita. All right? The word Oshita also stems from the Temerian word Usheta, or Washet, all right? Washet, Ur Washet. The symbol for Ur Washet was a sun disk with the wings spread out. This comes from Malachi, the 4th chapter, the 2nd verse, where it says, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings. So from immortal times, the symbol of the winged sun disk, Ur Washet, has been used to signify freedom and expansion of the mind, the soul, Ra-Atan. In the ancient Temerian, Egyptian, Kemetic myth of Osar, it is said that Heru defeated Set by becoming Ur-Washet, or the winged sun disk, which is symbolic to the all-encompassing divinity. In other words, your higher self. Heru defeated Set by becoming the Ur-Washet. The sacred form of Ur-Ashet, which is the winged disk, which is with the two Urays, or the two Rays, symbolizes the goddess Nebhet and the goddess Ur-Shet, which is a form of Aset. In other words, the Ida and the Pingala, which are the two sacral nerves at the base of the spine. It was decreed by Jehuti, which is Tahuti. Also, that's where we get the word Jew from, the origin of the word Jews, meaning that they follow the seven principles of Jehuti, the universal principles, which is mentalism, correspondence, polarity, rhythm, vibration, gender, which is sex, and cause and effect, which is karma. What goes around comes around. So they're claiming that they follow those particular principles or that school of thought of Tahuti or Jehuti, so hence the term Jew, hence the word Judah, hence the word Judah, hence the word Judas. Right? So on all of the walls in every temple, you will see the Ur-Washet decorated as a form of protection from evil. Now, this is taken from the Osirian resurrection mythology or myths. All right, you can get a book by Dr. Muwatta Ashby. It's called The Egyptian Tantric Yoga Guide to Love, Sex, Marriage, Relationships, and Spiritual Enlightenment. And he goes in on this information. And he speaks about the Urashet and how that was the epitome of the ancient Egyptian tantric mystical philosophy, as it is still today. You think CBS just happened to use the I? You think that's just a coincidence? It is the supreme understanding of all-encompassing, all-pervading, absolute existence. Therefore, the wings are used by both the gods and goddesses, or the Netzers, or the Netzerus, in the ancient Egyptian mythology, because the supreme deity or divinity encompasses both concepts of opposite, or what is actually referred to, as we would say, comparable. All right? Male and female are not opposites. They are complementary. All right? So, within this understanding, there cannot be evil since there is no duality. There is no opposites. This is where we must reach at. This is symbolic to the higher self that is spoken on within the Holy Quran, Circle 7. All right? This is the Holy Self, or the higher self, excuse me, in which that is spoken of within the 102 and the 101 information. All right, or questionnaires for Moorish children or Moorish Americans. All right, so we have to come back to this understanding. So this is the understanding that we have to come back to. All right? So it speaks about these duality, or these two forces fighting each other. This set in Heru, this lower self and higher self. All right? In the 102 and 101s, it says, how many selves are there? Two selves, higher self and lower self. All right, so this is what this is all referring to. So when the two merge, it becomes Urwashet or Washitor. This is what we're supposed to be mastering. Washitor is not a tribe. It was a priesthood in which that became known as a tribe. Okay? Or a nation. Or empire. Now, understand that families form tribes. Tribes or clans. Clans form tribes. Tribes form nations. Nations form empires. Understand the science here in which that is being taught. So there won't be any disagreements, because this is all I'm seeing. Is someone trying to explain something and they don't have the right information. If you read by Ms. Pearl. He wrote a book called The Memories Sir Curlis Papyrus, in which that he states that the goddess Urshet coming up from the underworld and would change the faces into things of beauty, into the brilliant eyes of light. I fly up and perch myself upon the forehead of Ra, in the bowls of the bowl, which is in heaven. I am the spiritual body of the sustainer of Mayat, which is made by the goddess Urshet. Now, what is that talking about? That's talking about the Kundalini raising up to the third eye, the pineal gland, to awaken Osar from his sleeping state. Africans believe that the unlimited power of individual godhood occurs when one sees God. So, of course, you know, whenever we get into the deep understanding in the Old Testament, Genesis 32:30, it says Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face, and my life has been preserved. Okay? Then Luke 11:34, the light of the body is the eye. Therefore, when the eye is single, the whole body will be filled with light. But when the eye is evil, the body is full of darkness. So this is the same eye that's on the back of the dollar bill, which is symbolic to the Urashet. It is not the eye of something evil, even though Your thoughts can pervert the energy into such. But in the hands of one who is holy, then it cannot be. All right? So this is the true meaning of Washita. It is of the priesthood. It is of the emergence of the lower self and the higher self. All right? Now, when you get, like if you read the Book of the Dead, it was by E.A. Wallace Budge. He states in there that the goddess Washet, which is the serpent-headed, Washet was a form of Hetheru or Hathor and was identified with the appearance of the sky in the north when the sun rose. She is either depicted in a form of a woman having upon her head the crown of the north and a scepter round which a serpent is twined, or as a winged Uraeus wearing the crown of the north. She has the principal goddess. She's the principal goddess of the town of Buto in the Delta. Okay? So this is what he says about Washet. All right? So it's the Kundalini as it raises up, that serpent, as it raises up to that eye. All right? As a matter of fact, I'm the Nuk Ankh Netur by Shechem or Shechem Ra'um and Nefer. Amen. He says that the Washet or the Ushet is another reference to the Eye of Ra and of Heru, and that the meaning carries strong strength, command, and protection, and are associated with the brain, which is commander, strong name, statutory laws. So that means that you are able to now put forth laws, to establish laws, once your third eye is now activated. You cannot establish law with your third eye blind. Running around here talking about you, Washita, but you're not exhibiting any of the high priest's traits. This can't continue to be happening. Because all the thinking which that is doing is the people are being deceived. You must practice this on a daily basis. You must try to purify yourself, and you must definitely attempt on a daily basis to master your lower self and raise yourself into your higher self. Some things will not always be explainable, but this is something that we have to do on a daily basis. The Ushet features predominantly in the story of the battle between Heru, the will, and against Set. Heru, the spirit force, operates through the core of the sun, which is the solar core of the earth. All right? And the brain, the pineal gland. It is the left eye of Heru that was injured, taken by Set, and had to be restored by Tahuti. So hence, Tahuti became the left eye, the principle of wisdom. The mystic marriage of the sun and moon in the spiritual and inoperative sense is the union of soul and spirit. All right? That is Osar, the soul, Osset, the Holy Spirit, to which they formed the Kares, the Christ, the Christos. All right? So we're not talking about a man from 2,000 years ago. And we're not definitely talking about Albion coming down in order to save you. This is all mythology in which that was purposely done against you as psychological warfare so that you can continue being oppressed, suppressed, and depressed. But the 300 years of Willie Lynch is ending. Willie Lynch came about 1712. Well, you add 300 years to that, that's 2012. So the spell is being broken. Dr. Malachi of York, he referred to it as the spell of Leviathan, the spell of Kingu. We call it the Willie Lynch syndrome, whatever term that you want to refer to it as. Post-traumatic syndrome of slavery. Whatever term that you want to refer to it as, it all comes out to the same thing. So, the Washita, their presence is all over the world. Here in the Americas, they were referred to as the Olmecs, who was here over 5,000 years ago. The Fosums, who was here over 70,000 years ago. The Twa people, who was here over 2 million years ago, right here in the western northern hemisphere. All right? We have information coming from Michael Cremo in his book, Forbidden Archaeology, where he states that there was humanoid beings on planet Earth 2.8 billion years ago. And 600 million years ago, right here in North America, they have found items in which that dates back that far. In Dorchester, right outside of Boston, Massachusetts, they have found bells, in which that means that there was people had at that time the ability in order to smelt iron metals, and that dated back to over 600 million years ago. So we're not talking about Dagnesh or Lucy 3 million years ago out of Africa. We're talking about further back than that. And we're talking about right here in the northern hemisphere, right here in what is called the Northern Gate or the North Gate of Omexum. This is the information that we need to be teaching. Do they have a connection to the word more? Of course it does. More just simply means dark-complected one. Melanite. Some want to use the word black, even though it dates no further back than 500 years ago. Understanding the concepts is what is going to be important for us. Because this is all based and been based on technology, hiding of information, destroying of documents and books. They burnt hundreds and thousands of books, tablets, scrolls. I mean, not just talking about recently, we're talking about over the last few thousands of years. This information has been destroyed purposely in order to hide your very existence. And it's been used recently in order to enslave you on your own land. Right here in America, even though some of you don't think that you are Americans. But the word America stems from the ancient Kemetic or Temerian word Amira, or Amaraku, or Al-Marak. So actually it was the acknowledgement of the deity Amen-Ra. How we notice, if you go to the Grand Canyon, or if you have done any research on the Grand Canyon, if you're going down into various caverns, which of course I believe you can't go down there nowadays, but there was articles in which that was written back in the 1909 in which that stated that they found over 18 various temples in which that majority of these temples was dedicated to the various gods of ancient Egypt, ancient Temerian. And that these particular areas was hundreds and thousands of years old, meaning that the ancient Egyptians were already here. And this information spread it out. In other words, it was already part of the ancient mystery school. The only time in history in which that we did not have the ancient mystery school is now. We always had it. Moderately, or in this day and time period, we do not have it. Or it has been shut off from us once again. It's called the secret society, and they themselves can't even decode the secrets majority of the time. So, I am part of the United Washita Dedugdumanya, Nation of Nagamores. We were accepted as part of the Empire Washita Dedugdumanya around May 15th, 2004, by Frederick Joe Washington, who is the Emperor's son. And we also went to go meet with the Empress during that time period. And the advice which she gave us was to study her book, The Return of the Ancient Ones. There are many who have not even read the book, but yet talking about Washita. I suggest you read the book before you open your mouth, because it's within there that you will find the case of Henry Turner versus the United States and the heirs of Henry Turner versus the United States, in which that they show specifically that the United States lost, and that the land in which that is referred to as Louisiana on up as part of Louisiana Purchase, which of course we know that it was never purchased. And I get more into that in a second. So since it was never purchased, there's more than 13 states on the way up into Canada in which that was part of what is referred to as Louisiana proper, misnomer, purchase. And that land belongs to those who are Washita. The Empress states that 85% of us prior to 400 years ago were Washita. The Albion came here, and in order to divide us, began to break us up into various categories of naming systems. And then around that time, they brought Africans here, and they mixed us in with the Africans and said, okay, all of us come from Africa in order to steal the land from us. It was all part of the ploy. So now if you get a ancestral genealogy paperwork done, you will come from Africa. Of course you come from Africa originally, but obviously that was more than 400 years ago. As we just finished breaking down, we told you that the Olmecs were here 5,000 years ago. The Fulsums were here 70,000 years ago. The Twa people was here 2 million years ago, and they are all, as we would refer to, as Moors or blacks, said blacks. At this meeting with Frederick Joe Washington, when he accepted us as being the First Nation state of the Empire, Washita Dedugdumanya, and the reason why this was accepted was because my teacher, Prince Ramesses Abel Bey, was the crown prince of the Empire Washita Dedugdumanya. And at the time, he felt it was necessary in order to preserve the information and the legacy and the history and the heritage of the Washita, because the Empress had three strokes from 2000 to 2003. All right? Strokes slash heart attacks. And from these strokes, she was paralyzed on her left side. All right? Now, when we seen her in 2004, she was very talkative, and she wanted to come and build with us and speak with us. You know, she was asking us our names and all this information. And like I said, the advice in which she gave us was to read her book, because the keys are within there. On June 7th, 1999, the Empress Verdiasi Tierra Turnica Washita Gaston L. Bay, she presented Prince Ramesses Abel Bay with the title Crown Prince, and hence brought him into her bloodline. Okay? So not only was he made the crown prince of the Empire Washita Dedugdumanya, he was brought into the bloodline. And so what happened is that he came to us in 2002. And by 2003, he gave certain people, positions as being chiefs, even though there was not originally any chiefs within the empire, Washoe Dida Dominion. There was ministers there, but we use the term chiefs instead, not because of Indians, because your, if you remember, your chief and commander is Obama, and he's, as we would say, not an Indian. So the term chief did not refer to Indian status. So please stop all that nonsense. Chief simply means leader. Actually, it would say servant of the people. That's actually what we're supposed to be doing, of being servants of the people. All right? A job of a chief, or the role of a chief, is that of a high priest. The chief himself or herself must strive and evolve into knowing this through discipline. For without discipline, the soul cannot enter the higher self or the higher realms of the divine mind. Or as we've said, into the heavens to commune with the ancestors or even your own past incarnations. Right? So, chiefs or the titles or were the titles in which that was given to us. I became the chief of information at the time. After Prince Ramesses Abel-Bey, or Prince Hutan Tupac Bey, as he became later called, when he passed in 2004, a chief council was held late one night in which that I was voted unanimously as being a prince of Washoe or United Washoe Dida Dominion. Now, the fact is that he brought us into his bloodline as chiefs. He was brought into the bloodline through the Empress. And, of course, the Empress already referred to 85% of us already was part of that bloodline. If you read We Are the Washitor by Brother Umar Shabazz, he states that the Tunica or Turner and the Washitor, Washington bloodlines, or the imperial bloodlines here in North America and North Mexico. And the names was changed to hide that identity. So Tunica became Turner, Washitor became Washington. Okay? So, this is the origin. All right? Now, there's certain things in which that, for those who are interested and want more information, y'all can contact us at 252-257-3588. That's 252-257-3588. And we have a disc of information, and you can hear Prince Ramesses Abel-Bey, or Prince Hutan Tupac Bey, as he became later known as. Actually, you will actually hear him speak out his mouth. All right? You will not hear me speaking. I'm sitting there as a child learning myself, even though he taught me ever since 1995, and he referred to me as his last student or his only student, because I stuck with him for many years of the information which that he was taught, I mean, which that was taught to me. I dedicated my book to him, in which that is called The First World Order, as well as also to the Empress. The Empress, because her 40 years of dedication to this information and getting this out to us in order to tell us that we were already here. Okay? Many don't know what is Washoe today. Well, Washoe Dida Dominion is an empire, a nation, a developing transitional government. The Washoe Dida Dominion proper is the seat of the imperial government. The Washoe Dida Dominion Moors are a nation of indigenous people. The Washoe is the land of the ancient ones. The Washoe Empire has a legacy over 100,000 years of rulership by the empresses. I showed you that the Ur-Washet was females. In other words, it was a matriarch. The empress of the Washoe Moors nation. She is the legitimate or the legal heir to the, that's who the empress is, to the Maison Rouge land grants that was skillfully wielded to her great-grandfather, Henry Turner, son of the Marquis Maison Rouge. So the Watch Store today is a place where the indigenous people can come to be their best. A legacy of original people and a land of opportunity for personal and spiritual growth. This is what we're supposed to be about. Where's the Watch Store today? The Watch Store, D.W. Munya Empire is unbound. The ancient ones, the mound builders live all over the earth. Everywhere you see a pyramid or a mound, we were there. As the Olmecs came up from out of the interior of the Yucatan Peninsula, the Mexican Gulf, they came up into and settled upon the Mississippi Valley or the Mississippi River. And Prophet Noble Dralee said that the Moors was all up and down the Mississippi, if you read his oral statements. That was referring to his Ouachita lineage and heritage. His mother was Eliza Turner. She was part of the landmark case of the heirs of Henry Turner versus the United States. Who won? His father was John Drew Kitman. Who was full-blooded Cherokee. Right here from out of North Carolina. So we have to know these things, all right? We have a lot of groups running around trying to reinvent the wheel when the information has already been presented as far as who are the inheritors of this land. If we put our goals towards helping return the land back to the proper status and to the original people, then we won't have to be having all these debates on which that I'm seeing and that I'm hearing, because this is undebatable. You can't debate me on none of this. I have the documents. You don't. So you'd be trying to debate from a lost position anyway. I'm no longer playing with you niggas. I'm tired of the bullshit. I'm fed up with this Moorish movement because we're supposed to be actually doing something for the people, not constantly debating about who's right and who's wrong. It won't even be necessary. Once again, if you need information, give me a call. 252-257-3588. The more information that you have, that we have, less debates, less problems, more work. Now, we know with the passing of the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People, that this gave us a leeway in order to utilize a lot of the documentations from the past and to actually put our status on public record. But even before we get there, we go to the King Alfred Plan, or what's called Rex 84, in which that Ronald Reagan signed in 1984, which was Executive Order 11490. Originally, in the memo that was in lieu of a full report from the Joint Chief of Staff, the report states that the minorities will be able to put into the streets a superior number of people who are desperate and dangerous-willed. He will be a formidable enemy, for he is bound to the continent by heritage and knows that political asylum would not be available to him in other countries. We are bound to the continent by heritage. If you look up the word heritage, heritage means something handed down from one ancestor or the past as a characteristic, a culture, tradition, etc. the rights, burdens, or status resulting from being born in a certain place or time, a birthright. A birthright. The reason why Moors is used, even though there is no black land, Negro land, Moor land per se, unless you know how to break down the word Al-Morak, which is a maxim, which is also America, but the land itself, if you read within the Black's Law Dictionary, 4th edition, it says that in the most general sense, comprehended as any ground, soil, or earth whatsoever, including fields, meadows, pastures, woods, moors, waters, marshes, and rocks. In this more limit sense, land denotes the quantity and characteristics, and the character of the interest or estate, which a person may own in land. It may include any estate or interest in land, either legal or equitable, as well as easements and incorporeal hereditaments. The land is one thing, and the estate in land is another thing. For an estate in land is a time in land, or land for a time. The term may be used interchangeably with property. It may include anything that may be classed as real estate or real property. See also lands, ownership, parcels, heritage, property, real property. As an example, real property is also your physical body, real estate. So this is Black's Law Dictionary. Also, you can get Black's Law Dictionary 6th edition. So the word, so anytime you say more, you also talking or referring to the land. In Black's Law Dictionary 4th edition, they define more as an officer of the Isles of Man who summons the court for several shreddings. The office is similar to the English bailiff of 100. So one more is actually worth 100 bailiffs, which is 100 sheriffs. The word bailiff is derived from the Arabic word bay or baya, which means governor, landlord, or ruler. You go to Webster Dictionary, a Moor, a dark-complected people, a member of any African or Asian dark race who are adopting the Mohammedan religion. A Negro, a black. See black or more. So, we know that the original Arabs were blacks. This is within Sex and Race by J. Rogers, Volume 1. So let's not be confused. Are the Arabians Africans? Yes, just like you are calling American, you originally came from Africa. But that was millions and millions of years ago. Not just recently, 400 years ago. Where you get 50% of your bloodline did extend from recently. But we're talking about several impacts, as we spoke about earlier. Even within the Holy Quran, Circle 7, I think it was Egypt, the capital empire of the Dominion of Africa. It says the Moabites from the land of Moab, who received permission from the pharaohs of Egypt to settle and inhabit Northwest Africa. So America was Northwest Africa. They were the founders and the true possessors of the present Moroccan Empire. All right, if you get John Henry Clark, the African, Christopher Columbus, and the myth of the New World, he says in there, it must also be added that Amerigo Vespucci on his voyage to the Americas witnessed the Mandingos of the Malians and the Songhai Empire, later identified as the Moroccan Empire, out of the Atlantic returning to Africa. Once again, I got to say it, John Henry Clark in The Africans, Christopher Columbus, and the Myth of the New World, he states, it must also be added that Amerigo Vespucci on his voyage, now this was Amerigo Vespucci, supposedly, of course his name was actually Alberto Vespucci. He got the term Amerigo because of the name in which that he heard amongst the natives. When he asked them who they were, or he was trying to communicate with them about where he was actually at, and that's the name in which that they referred to it as, was Amerigo. or Miracle or Miracle. So he took that nickname, all right? And so Americo Vespucci, as they would say, on his voyage to the Americas, witnessed the Mandingos of Mali. Who is that? That is the Omecs and the Songhai Empire, which later is identified as the Moroccan Empire, out in the Atlantic returning to Africa. In the article, African Explorers of the New World by Arnold G. Lawrence, he makes this statement: we can now positively state that the Mandingos of Mali and the Songhai Empire, or possibly other Africans, crossed the Atlantic to carry on trade with the Western Hemisphere Indians, and further succeeded in establishing colonies there throughout the Americas. This is the second impact on America. The first impact is that the term Indian is derived from Christopher Columbus, misnomer, because within Latin, the word Indian is derived from the word Indios, which means God's people. And which that within the Sanskrit means black people. Indy, India, dark-skinned, complected people. So I'm not per se caught up on the term black in that regard. We definitely have to understand the origin of these words. This is more important than me debating. All right? We know that supposedly black means in science, death. We know that is attributed to Webster Dictionary as being evil. And so forth and so on. But we're talking about dark-skinned, complected people, brown-skinned, complected people. So, when you get to the United Nations definition of indigenous, those people having a historical continuity with pre-invasions and pre-colonial societies consider themselves distinct from the other sectors of the societies now prevailing in those territories, a part of them. They form at present a non-dominant sector of society and are determined to preserve, develop, and transmit to future generations their ancestral territories and their ethnic identities as the basis of their continued existence as a people in accordance with their own cultural patterns, social institutions, and legal systems. All right, now you read the Inter-American Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People that was approved September 18, 1995. They get into the definition of indigenous people. It says, in this declaration, indigenous people are those who embody historical continuity with societies which existed prior to the conquest and settlement of their territories by Europeans, as well as people brought involuntarily to the New World who freed themselves. So, hold up. As well as people brought involuntarily to the New World who freed themselves. So this also includes Africans. We are all Africans, so let's not get this twisted. But what I'm simply saying is that we're talking about several impacts, and the last impact was 400 years ago. And that particular impact of 400 years ago brings us now to the situation in which that we've been in for the last 400 years, in which that has been used in order to steal land from those in which that was already here, who was part of the Omecs, who was part of the Fosuns, who was part of the Twa people. And it says, as well as people brought involuntarily to the New World who freed themselves. So we know that when we get into this argument, according to J. Roger Sex and Race, Abraham Lincoln was a Moor. He was of Moorish heritage. So in other words, Abraham Lincoln being a Moor, he freed the Moors. Hence, they free themselves, and culture from which that they have been torn, as well as tribal people whose social, cultural, and economic condition distinguish them from other sectors of the national community, and whose status is regulated wholly or partially by their own customs and traditions or by special laws or regulations. Listen to this. Self-identification as indigenous or tribal shall be regarded as a fundamental criteria for the determining the group to which the provision of this declaration applies. So you must have your own identification as being indigenous or tribal. This is what the Washita have done. We have our own identification, our own recognition within our tribe. The use of the term peoples in this instrument shall not be construed as having any implication with respect to other rights that may be attached to the term in international law. So you have to understand is that this information has a lot of bearing if it's used properly. Now, when we get to the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, we're actually referring to certain of particular articles. I won't get into all of the articles here, but we will definitely get into some of these articles. Like, for example, Article 3, Indigenous people have the right to self-determination. By virtue of the right, they freely determine their political status and freely pursue their economic, social, and cultural development. All right? Article 4, Indigenous people, in exercising their right to self-determination, have the right to self-autonomy or self-government in matters relating to their internal and local affairs, as well as ways and means for financing their autonomous functions. Article 6, every indigenous individual have the right to a nationality. Why? Because a nationality ties you back to land. I just finished reading to you the definition of land has the word moors embedded inside of it. So that means any place that a so-called black person goes to on this planet is the land, because we are the original people on this planet. You have many cultures from the Moria, Sumerian or Sumerian, Timorian or Timerian, America, Amorica, Al-Moroccan. These are all places in which that the Moors have gone, and these lands are still named after, or at one time was named after, the Moors. All right? This is the information that I was showing in the debate with my brother Seti, in which that he didn't quote not one passage from Dr. Ben. I did, in which that showed Dr. Ben in Cultural Genocide, where he states that the word Moor, the first word that he used in talking about one of the most honorable names in which that has been used by so-called said black people. And the first word was the word Moor. So he dragged Dr. Ben, who was in his 90s, out to hear all of this rah-rah and did not show not one quote from Dr. Ben. So this is the nonsense in which that's been going on. And for those in which that feed into it, then be my guest. Article 9, Indigenous people and individuals have the right to belong to an indigenous community or nation in accordance with the traditions and customs of the nation or community or nation concerned. No discrimination of any kind may arise from the exercise of such a right. That's what we're supposed to be enforcing instead of bickering. We have the right to belong to an indigenous community or nation according to our traditions and customs, and no discrimination of any kind is supposed to arrive. If you get the I-9 form, on the I-9, which is a federal form, it specifically says that Native American documents is supposed to be accepted. The word Native is derived from the word indigenous. In other words, Native, born here, connected to indigenous. All right? Article 12, Indigenous people have the right to manifest, practice, develop, and teach their spiritual and religious traditions, customs, and ceremonies. The right to maintain, protect, and have access and privacy to their religious and cultural sites. The right to use and control of their ceremonial objects, the right to their human remains. All right, so this is where the Moral Science Temple of America comes in at. If you read the 101, 102, it says Noble Ali was raised on the Cherokee Reservation. Of course, some are trying to turn that around, say that that he was of slave birth, and that the Cherokee accepted the blacks who ran away into their tribe. This is some of the historical nonsense in which that is being taught. And so, in order for those who the lighter skin Cherokee, who I say is damn near white, who is actually Irish or Scottish blood, they are now have gotten rid of their darker brothers and sisters, as we would say, the so-called black Cherokee. But the majority of the black Cherokees were not even on reservations anyway. If you ask any family in North Carolina, any so-called black family in North Carolina, about their heritage, their great-grandmothers or great-grandfathers or grandmothers and grandmothers, grandfathers would tell you that they are taught that they were Cherokee. Now, how can that possibly be? My great-grandmother died at 101 years old, almost 102 years old. She was born in 1903. All right, she died in 2005. Her mother and father would have been near the time of the ending of slavery. Their mother and father would have been so-called slaves. My grandmother never repeated not one story about no slavery. What she did say, my great-grandmother did not repeat one story about slavery. What she did say was, is that the white man, the only thing he wanted to do is steal your land. And that was a warning because her land was always wanted by the European, by the Albions, in which that lived there within her area. Because her land was close or in back of the Cape Fear River. And that was right here in North Carolina. Not too far away from where they say that Prophet Noble Dry Leaf was born at. Or raised at, as we would say, on the Cherokee Reservation. Remember, that came through his father, who was John Drew Quitman, who was full-blooded Cherokee. His mother family was from out of Louisiana, Eliza Turner. And like I said, you can get the landmark cases in order to verify that the heirs of Turner versus the United States and Henry Turner versus the United States in order to verify this information. Article 35 says indigenous people have the right to determine the responsibility of the individuals to their communities. All right. Indigenous people, it says all rights and freedoms recognized herein are equal guaranteed to male and female indigenous individuals. All right, so these are just some of the articles. And we're going to go to questions right now. Caller ended in 0724.
This is Osiris of Osiris Third Dynasty here in Florida.
Yes.
And I really enjoy what you're saying tonight because when I started, I only made a phone call to your Princess Khadija here a couple of years ago, looking for a family sure name because I wanted to give up the slave name.
Right.
And I came into a lot of knowledge since that time, and I've claimed Washita since that time also for myself and my children. And in the process of time, we have established a temple here in Florida to help our people here on this end in Crescent City. And quite a few of our brothers down here and sisters here in Crescent City have come to their awareness, and they are claiming their Moorish rights.
Okay.
And that's great, and I really appreciate what you're doing because I've learned a lot from you.
Well, I appreciate
that. You are my son, Mason, which I learned Mason is not just Mason.
Right.
But my great mother, Allah, is my son.
Right.
So she recognizes us as being her sons, S-U-N, not S-O-N.
Right.
But I really appreciate that, and I want to give you high regards, you and Princess Khadija, for the work that you've done in our lives.
Thank you. Thank you. Paula, you're on the line. 7277.
Blessings.
Peace and blessings.
Peace and blessings. Yes, man. I've been getting the knowledge from all locations. It's been a blessed vibe. And I've been reading my papers. So when you started hitting the articles in this section, that's what I feel I should be addressing to them in any form, in any means in a forum because they have to acknowledge the Washita indigenous people. So I'm appreciating the energy because we don't have to be figuring and talking to them about no different other ways of the commercial ways. You just gotta give them the facts and what it is. So I appreciate the vibration, you know.
That's what it's supposed to be going by. Exactly, brother.
Yes.
It's supposed to be going by, being that December the 16th of this past year, 2010, Obama signed into acceptance of the Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People. So their courts are supposed to be, and that's all the courts, whether it's the Article 3 court, in which that no one knows where it is, but it's supposed to be the United States Supreme Court. But for some reason, they claim that the last one is now in Hawaii. It was once in Washington, D.C. It was once in New York, and now all of a sudden the last one is in Hawaii. Who the hell can get to Hawaii?
For real.
So this is the nonsense that they're doing because they don't want an Article 3 court here because they want these Article 2 and Article 1 courts to continue trying to pass laws in their de facto courts. You know, Article 3 court is the only de jure court. And that's why they have moved it off this the mainland soil. So these are games in which that they're trying to play and that they've been playing. We know that under Study ISIS, which is under when you go to court and there's laws in which that correlate in same cases or different cases, and these are laws in which that correlate, they're supposed to abide by the rulings from these other laws. So if you're talking about our indigenous status, and we'll put this on the record in the form of affidavits, and the affidavits was never rebutted, then you shouldn't even be able to proceed in your court case. Especially if you're standing there saying that, no, I do not understand the charges being brought up against me. But they have a tendency of now doing so. So these are the games in which that they're playing, and we have to become more confident in who we are, through our research, through our study, and begin to start saying these things boldly. One time I seen a brother just get mad and start cussing up in court, and they damn dropped the charges right then and there. Brother, like, God damn, I ain't got time to be keep coming up here messing around with y'all. I gotta go to work. Shit, that damn dude said, Your Honor, I think I'm going to go and dismiss the charges. Put his hat on and walk the hell out. And that's just from a nigga getting mad. So, these are things in which that we got to recognize. My wife and I, we have won basically all of our court cases based on nationality.
not using the UCC. Can you use the UCC? Of course you can. No doubt about it. It can be used. However, the foremost information that you must learn, that you must understand, overstand, understand, is your nationality. That pertains to your status. That pertains to your birthright.
This is why, family, we don't avoid ear calls. You know, we'll sit on the phone, and especially if you put forth donations and vibrations to that which we're making manifest. Because we cannot be in Florida, North Carolina State Republic, and California State Republic, we can when we come together and communicate. We also continue to learn from each other and also from our own experiences. So this is why we don't avoid your calls. You know, we truly are here for the people. I just wanted to add that on. Okay, we have another question from 910 area code ending in 2620. Well, we see y'all are jamming, so we'll let you do that. Area code 312-3916. You have a question?
Go ahead, Bayou.
Peace. Dr. Lee?
Yes. Hey, I tell you, Washington East. Greetings. How you doing?
Greetings, greetings, greetings. This is Noble Park. You're doing a
greetings,
fine job. How you doing? I'm down here in the Washington proper, the Washington South Territory, known as the Louisiana Territory, known as Louisiana Republic Territory, Orleans.
Yes.
You also forgot to mention that 1828 and 1825, that's the Under British Dictionary, dealing with the term America, when it said that it was dealing with the aboriginal indigenous Capitone race that was found by the Europeans who now take the term and use it upon themselves as a descendants of Europeans born over here in the North American continent.
Oh, I didn't forget. I was getting ready to get to it, but I'm glad you said it. So, shoot, thank you. Repeat that one more time so everybody can get that down pat.
Yes, you can go to the Webster Online Unabridged Dictionary of 1828 and 1825, where it states that the term America was for the Capitone race of the aboriginal indigenous people who was found here by the Europeans when they came over. Now they use the term America for those descendants of Europeans over here to designate themselves as American. And right there with that definition, they let you know that they was dealing, identity theft again.
So you're saying that they are not original, that they are not Americans?
No, they are not Americans because it's stated that the Americans were your aboriginal indigenous copper tone. If you know what copper is, if you take a penny and put it to your skin, you have many shades of copper. You have that red copper, you have dark copper, then you have the double chocolate copper, as we say, Shakta, right? We just had the powwow on Zoom. Huh?
That's a Choctaw, right.
Yeah, that's what they called us after they tried to baptize, but we actually say shock, right?
Right, the Choctaw Washington, Choctaw.
Yeah. So dealing with that, you know, it's very much needed that everyone become aware of the aboriginal indigenous right. We just had the powwow on Juneteenth, which also was dealing with the Lange court case that was actually done in 1848. And also dealing with that, you had Judge Taney, who was the one who actually gave his opinion, who actually helped rule on the verdict of the aboriginal indigenous family of the Tunica. And then 11 years later, you had Dred Scott, when he actually was dealing with that court case. Not too many people know of that either. You know, he played a very important part, so he actually knew who a slave and who was aboriginal, because he actually was involved in both of the cases. And with that, I say Kunimi.
Exactly. Exactly. Now, to back up everything in which that Brother Noble Paul is talking about, there's many books that you can go to promote your signs and symbols of man, by Albert Churchward, the Sousa Economics, the historical from the history of Pan-African trade, commerce, money and wealth, these blacks found in the Americas, in which that specifically says the mountain builders, they were dark-skinned, woolly-haired blacks who were indigenous, natives of North America and kin to the Olmecs of South America. There were Olmecs and the Washita, black Californians, Yamasees, and other pre-Columbian blacks of the Americas were part of the prehistoric trade network that began in Africa and spread it worldwide over 100,000 years ago at various periods afterwards. Also, you can read the history of the African Olmecs. It says the black Olmecs dominated Mexico and Central America for about 3,113 years before Christ to about 400 years after Christ. They happen to be the descendants of the what happened to the descendants of the Olmecs? Well, here's the shock of facts. The Olmecs spread throughout the Americas, building settlements and trading all over the region. Many remained in Mexico, some mixed out of existence. You know what I'm saying? The vast majority left their settlements and returned to trading and maritime activities between Africa and Americas by the time of Columbus' visit. And some of the descendants of the Olmecs settled amongst the Mississippi Valley, Texas, and southern, southwest, and eastern United States. They became victims of kidnapping for enslavement, which the edict to enslave all descendants of Ham was founded in the new land was passed by the Vatican, the church, one of the papal bulls. So hence today in the Americas, the present community of blacks from Brazil to Canada are a mix of Olmec, Washita, black Californians, Yamasee, the Gala, the black Caribs, and those slaves brought to America after Columbus. All right? So the Olmecs never disappeared, but moved to remote parts of Central America, Mexico, and or were turned into slaves in the United States, as they became as it became known as. All right? If you read Africans and Native Americans by Jack D. Forbes, he shows in the book that so-called Indians were then shipped to Spain and sold, and over 3,000 indigenous or Indians were known to have been shipped to Europe from America between 1493 and 1501 during the so-called Columbus expeditions. These so-called Native Americans or Indians were classified as Negroes and blacks in the slave books of Seville, Spain, and elsewhere. So they always were changing the name. How come we are the only people that changed our names every damn 30 years? In 1900, we was called what? Come on. We was called what? Negroes. By 1930, we became colored. By 1960, we became blacks. By 1990, we became African Americans. I guess it might take us another 10 years to get called Moors, based on this Moorish paradigm. According to a history of African Olmecs, it says not a single European nation, tribe, or kingdom is responsible for the presence of blacks in the Americas. The very first people of the Negroid African race arrived in the Americas over 30,000 years ago, according to National Geographic. It was the article called The Peopling of America. All right, in another book, The Forgotten Truth Behind Racism in America, The Hidden Ancestral Identity of Black Americans, Volume 1, it says the new fertile homeland was given to the black American mound builders as promised before floods separated the East from the West. In Earthway, a newsletter of the Sojourner Truth Farm School, the Freedom Press newsletter, The Empress states this in 1996. She says that the Washita were and still is a nation of Africans who existed in the southern United States in Mississippi Valley region long before the 16th century Europeans arrived, and even before there were Native Americans on the land. The Washita was occupied and still occupied today. The indigenous people have been all over the world, and specifically on the North American continent for hundreds and thousands of years. Actually, there were some Washita here even before the Africans arrived. They intermingled. All the continents of the world were one. Their land, the lands of the earth, were known by the indigenous term Mu, in which that we refer to it now as Pangaea. The word Pan is the land word in which that means all. Mu means the word Mu means water. All right, so. Also, once again, another book, Africans Before Columbus, by Basil Davidson. He speaks about the fact of blacks being here in the New World before Columbus. All right? Von Wittenu, he wrote called Unexpected Faces in Ancient America, in which he states there is just a few of historians who support these theories. And he states that the Africans were here prior to Columbus. All right? Man, I can go on with the documentation. America Holocaust, Columbus and the Conquest of the New World by David E. Stannard. He says the oldest civilization known in the Americas were the Omecs, and it was a black Africoid origin and flourished over a 5,000-year period. This civilization extended into Americas before the arrival of the Red Indians. In fact, at the time of European arrival in Central and South America in the 15th century, descendants of the black Omecs were abounding throughout that region, particularly in Mexico. Right? In the Lost Realms, by Zachariah Ascension. He writes on the mysteries of the Omecs, by David Hatchin Childress. They both state that blacks was already here in the Western Hemisphere, and that the Western Hemisphere belonged to the Omecs. And What They Never Told You in History Class by Indu Kimit Kush. He writes that the first Americans were black. And it states that Latin author C.C. McGuise, it is likely, we repeated, the long ago, the youthful America was also a Negro continent, and that the Otomis of Mexico and the Caracos of Haiti and the Mataya of Brazil and the Albions or Albinos of Panama are the remains of the Aboriginal Negro race out of which developed later what is known as the Red or American race. So once again, all these authors have stated the fact that we was here prior to the Red Indians. So they're not the original natives or the most indigenous people here. We are. Point blank. So we're going to go back to some more questions. Caller ended in 7565. You're on the air. Area code 609, you're on the air.
Hello?
Yes, greetings.
Oh, hey, peace.
Peace.
I was just want to say that I'm enjoying the material, enjoying the everything that's given. Dr. Lean, Amir Kadir, just keep doing what y'all doing. Definitely, you know what I'm saying, sharing the information with us. And like I said, I'm just loving the talk and everything. So,
appreciate it. No, thank you, brother. Thank you. Thank you, Wap. All right. Caller ending in 5981. You're on the line. You're on the air.
Greetings, Dr. Allen Bay. This is Jonathan Fisher, a.k.a. Issachar Bay. I'm a new brother that just joined you guys last week with Kadira out of Las Vegas.
Yes, brother Issachar. How you doing?
Yeah, man, I'm looking forward to sitting under your teachings and learning everything I can. There's an older gentleman out here who's also a Ouachita Moor, and he's out of Detroit, and he had the opportunity to kind of sit under the Empress as well. So, you know, he's not here tonight. I was actually trying to get him on the call because he's going to be very excited to know that I'm getting ready to claim my nationality and really get up under some good teaching with you guys. We're doing a couple things out of here. I'm the founder of the Enlightenment Center. We're doing metaphysics. I teach astrology, numerology, and also Reiki healing. So we got a couple things going on out here, man. But I love what I'm learning, man. And like I said, man, I watch your videos, and I've been keeping in contact with Kadira, and you guys definitely going to be hearing from me a lot. And I'm trying to buy up everything you got, man, all your videos, your books, everything, man. So, you know, anybody that's listening, man, I would tell you, man, that, you know, definitely listen to what the brother's saying. He's really kicking out some good knowledge. He's really trying to save us and trying to open our eyes to see what's going on. And, you know, I'm just grateful that I could be a part of this. And I also thank you, man, for taking the opportunity to not be selfish and also get this knowledge for yourself, but that you're willing to part it and partake of it and give it out to the masses, those who want it and those who need it. So I thank you, brother. Peace.
Oh, thank you. Peace, bro. All right, we're going to go back into the info right quick and then get back to some more questions in a second. All right, let's go to Africans and Native Americans by Jack D. Forbes. He says on page 69 that in 1524, the people of the Carolina coast were said to be as dark-colored, not much unlike the Ethiopians. In the Charlotte Observer, dated stated August the 15th, 1993, states that North Carolina in 1690 reports the presence of Moors and that they are the ancestors of a people erroneously called Melungeons. See, I'm going straight to the information. That's what I'm saying. This shit ain't debatable. I got hundreds and thousands of books that can prove this shit. The Empress says, within an article from Inner City Plow, she says, in Louisiana, continuing her quest to bring truth to light, Empress Vodiasi Tierra Washington Tonica Gaston L. Bay, recalling 40 years of work, including research as an archivist in order to locate documents and treaties concerning lands known as the Louisiana Purchase, in which her people are identified as the ancient ones. The Empress say their land was never included in any land deal and that it was not part of the Louisiana Purchase when sold by Spain to France, nor was it bought in 1803 when France rolled it over to the United States. She writes, President Thomas Jefferson was well aware of this fraudulent land deal and stated his sentiments at the time. In truth, the land spoken of has never been part of the United States of America. It has always belonged to the ancient ones. This sounds like the same land President Abraham Lincoln was going to return to the Moors after slavery. He called it the Egypt of the West and or the Central America, the lands between the Rocky and the Allegheny Mountains, from the coast of Mexico up into Canada, on both sides of the Mississippi. In 1848, the Ouachita, also the Ouachita and Turnica nations, took their land case before the United States Supreme Court and won their case under Judge Taney, the same judge who in 1856 gave his opinion, which was not a legal decision, in the tragic Dred Scott case. Now, the Dred Scott case was never repealed or changed, however, which basically states that there is nothing that a black man has that a white man is bound to respect. The result of this opinion meant further slavery and death to the Ouachita, Turnica, and the other nations. They was murdered by the tens of thousands. Enslaved, ran off their lands. The names were changed to hide the truth of their history. The Ouachita became Washington, and the Turnica became Turner. Now, this is what the Empress stated. All right? Now, what this means is that when we hear about the Haitian connection, because we have to add that into it, the Haitian connection, we have to realize is that supposedly the United States would not have acquired the land if it was not for the Haitians' fight against Napoleon during 1803. Now, the land, as we just finished, what we just finished reading, according to the Empress, that was a fraudulent land deal. The only land in which that they actually were supposed to have acquired was actually a couple of streets and barracks, military barracks in New Orleans. One was Bourbon Street, where they still have the Mardi Gras Festival at yearly. That was it. The whole of Louisiana and the Louisiana Purchase was never purchased. They sent Napoleon, who was supposed to have $15 million in gold, they sent him $11,250,000 in gold. The other $3,075,000 in gold sunk beneath the ocean floor off the coast of Florida. And it never reached him. So the monies was never rendered. So therefore, service cannot be transpired. There is no proof of this land land deal taking place. We've already showed you and demonstrated, according to the heirs of Turner, as well as also the heirs of Henry Turner, as well as the Henry Turner versus the United States, as well as also the King versus the United States. Those three particular court cases, dating back to 1846, they have proven that this land was never acquired by the Albion, all the way up into Canada. So a lot of these groups are trying to reinvent the wheel instead of actually joining on and participating in what they need to.
And stealing from the people.
Oh, and as my wife says, stealing from the people.
They can't get their stuff from you, can't get a hold of you.
You know what I'm saying?
What kind of mess is that?
People can't get in contact with individuals from these other groups after they have given them their money. You won't get that shit here.
You sure won't.
This is the truth of the matter. That's why we had spiritual teachings before we even got into this physical shit. I've been studying this metaphysics and this occult information for almost 25 years. This is the realness of this. I am sincere and I will continue to be. Now, when we get into the connection between the MSTA or the Morris Holy Temple of Science or the Morris Science Temple of America with Prophet Noble Dry Lee, he comes through the connection of, as we have said, Eliza Turner. Now, this is what we've been able to find out, that Henry Joseph Turner became the recipient of the 1762 and 1795 Imperial Spanish land grants, or he became the third Marquis of the de Maison Rouge. All right? Matilda Garson married William Bill Badger, and from this union came the oldest son, Isham Washington, or Washington. Now, Henry Joseph Turner married Sarah Turnica, and from this union came the eldest son, Joseph Henry Turner, who became the fourth Marquis de Maison Rouge. Now, Isham married Delphina Badger, and from this union came the eldest son, Frederick Houston Washington. And Joseph Henry Turner, whose sister is Eliza Turner, the mother of Prophet Noble Dry Lee, married Matilda, and from this union came the eldest daughter, Annie Frankie Turner. All right, then Frederick Houston Washington, the regent of the Empire Washington, Duke of Maine, married Annie Frankie Turner, the recipient of the 1762 and 1795 Spanish land grants, and the heir of Henry Joseph Turner estate. The eldest daughter of Frederick and Frankie is the current Imperial Empress of the Washitor, which is Verdiasi Tierra Washington. Now, Verdiasi was married to John Gaston, who was the son of Corella Turnica. All right? And Corella was the daughter of Eliza Turner, who was the sister of Prophet Noble Dry Lee. And Eliza is the mother of Prophet Noble Dry Lee, Corella, and as we would say, Dry Lee and Corella, they were brothers and sisters. Then Eliza is the daughter of Sarah Turnica and Henry Joseph Turner. And John Gaston had been the sixth Marquis de Maison Rouge after Noble Dry Lee, who had been the fifth Marquis de Maison Rouge. So Noble Dry Lee was the regent of the Empire Washington de Duc de Maine. He was the fifth Marquise Dijon Maison Rouge, or D. Maison Rouge. So when Noble Dry Leaf, you read the oral statements, and he said that I am the five times more powerful than I was, he's talking about that he is the fifth of the Maison D. Maison Rouge, Marquise D. Maison Rouge. And this is how he tied the land and through these various land grants. So this is the land in which that the Moral Science Temple of America is speaking about, in which that supposedly been put within the express trust, but yet no one can show me the documentation. Well, I have the land grants. I can show you the documentation of the Washita. So this is the connection between the Empress, between Prophet Noble Dry Leaf. All right, and the reason why he put the information under a religious protection, utilized within by becoming incorporated within a state, it would give you some type of being part and parcel, not necessarily a United States citizen, because the 14th Amendment was never fully ratified. It was taken before over 19 states. And 15 of those 19 states rejected it. And then it was never brought up again to the remainder 31 states, in which that was supposed to be half 50. And it's supposed to have taken 3/4 of the states in order to pass it. So therefore, it was never fully ratified. So you are not a U.S. citizen. And according to the opinion of Judge Taney from the Dred Scott case, you would never be. Why? Because that decision was never changed nor repealed. It is still the United States Supreme Court case decision. So an act does not supersede a United States Supreme Court ruling. A bill do not supersede a United States Supreme Court case ruling. An amendment that is never ratified cannot supersede a United States Supreme Court case ruling. So this means, according to the Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People, you have the right to self-determination and the ability in order to identify yourself as a nation or a community as you so see and as you choose. Stop playing. You have the right to tie yourself back to the land mass, to an ancestry, to a heritage, to a birthright. So, in the United States versus the Turner heirs, it states Sarah Turner, Eliza Turner, Henry Turner, and George Washington and George W. Turner are the true and lawful owners of and has good title against the United States, the defendants in and to all the lands and hereditament claimed by them in their raided petitions, which lands are described as follows on a map or surveyed, executed on 27th March 1820, in which that they mark over 68,883 acres of land. And the Empress is going to go for another million to 3 million, and then eventually for the whole 15 million, in which that stretches all the way up into Canada, because it is all part of the Louisiana so-called purchase. This is what we're supposed to be doing. You want to know what you're supposed to be doing? Not bickering about what Prophet Noble Dry Leaf bought. Because you don't know, because none of you niggas ever seen him. Stop lying to yourselves. Stop thinking that you're the supreme great this and great that. You're a Negro trying to imitate something that you never experienced. And that's the truth of the matter. Experience Allah in man. That's what you need to be experiencing. By doing so, you can never go wrong. And you're always on the path of Allah, the Sirat al-Mustaqim. Tired of shit. Fucking Negroes. Claiming to be Moors. Anyway, Eliza Turner, even according to the state of Louisiana, the Division of Administration's the State Land Office, January 8, 1992, says Daniel W. Cox, 10,000 acres of the Maison Rouge Grant. Harrison, 16,000 acres of the Maison Rouge Ranch, a Maison Rouge Grant. G.W. Turner, 10,000 acres of the Maison Rouge Grant. C.J. Hershey, 2,800 acres of the Maison Rouge Ranch, Henry Turner, 1,928 acres. Henry Turner, 5,519 acres. Sarah Tyler, 5,600 acres. Harrison, 16,000 acres. Eliza Turner, 1,036 acres. So this is the family acres in which that comes up to 68,883 acres of land. All right, we're going to go back. There's more questions. Ended at 9226. You're on the line. Area code 404. You're on the line. You're on the line.
You hear me, brother?
Yes, we can.
Okay. I have a question. Where does the esoteric teachings, you know, with Kundalini energy, how does that tie into what we're doing, you know, as a nation with the paperwork and legal battles? Do you think that any of this work we're doing with metaphysics can help with our struggle with, you know, with our rights as indigenous people?
Well, according to the definition in which that we went over earlier on what Washita mean and its origin from the ancient Kemetic word Washita or Ushita, which means the epitome of enlightenment, which is talking about the sun disk with the wings from it, which is the top part of the Uranus or the Caduceus on the medical symbols, which is spread out throughout the United States as well as probably throughout the world. That same symbol is the carrier of Nagal within the Sumerian text, is the carrier of Imhotep and Tahuti, all the wars of ancient Kemet or Temeria. So that symbolizes, the top part symbolizes the raised Kundalini to the pineal gland. So we as indigenous people are supposed to be working on that daily. So not just practicing and participating within the commerce or trade, because actually when you break down the word commerce, it means intercourse. As in sexual intercourse, trade. So we know that the quickest way to raise the Kundalini is through sex. So this is part of the metaphysics of the occult sciences. So we're supposed to be practicing and raising our Kundalini on an everyday basis through proper breathing. Matter of fact, within the Holy Quran Circle 7, the second chapter specifically speaks about what we must teach as being the sons or the revealers of light. It says that we must teach that Allah and man is one. We also must teach about the holy breath and how it harmonizes and brings peace within man. All right, so we must teach, this is all paraphrasing, but we must teach the holy breath. So what is the holy breath? The holy breath is the science of breathing, the science of breath. We know that we can go without food for 30 days, water 2 weeks, breath 3 minutes. So the most important primary source of life is the breath itself. All right? Esoterically, that is Shu, which is the personification of air in ancient Egypt, who was the son of Atum. All right? Within the Bible, Jesus, who Aramaic name and Hebrew name is Yahshua, becomes the second Adam. Just like Shu is the second Adam or the first begotten son of Atum. This is all based on the ancient Kemetic script. The Bible is nothing more than a summary of the book of coming forth by day and night, or what is misnomer in the book of the dead by on Wallace Budge. All right? The Bible actually is part of what is called the evolution and the rising of Ra. So we all supposed to be dealing with this information from an esoteric, metaphysical, or occult standpoint. And for those who get so caught up into just the material plane, they're the ones in which that suffer. Because they have no balance. You're supposed to have 1 foot in heaven and 1 foot on earth. Supposed to be balanced. That's the laws of Mayat.
I say, brother, and that kind of goes into my next question, because I've gone through the many schools of teachings of Moors, and I've joined a temple myself, changed my name, had plates, got arrested, spent 2 months in jail. No Moors came to my aid. The courts didn't honor anything I said. They were getting ready to put me in a straitjacket. And my thing is, if these Europeans obviously don't have honor, not the ones in the courts. I mean, some do, but for the most part, if our people's freedom had to depend on it, we'd all be slaves, if history's taught anything. So when I say, does this raising the Kundalini, is this supposed to free us from our human plight? Is this supposed to free us from, being free in our land? Is this supposed to free us from being free from this world? Or is it supposed to do both? Do you feel that we are going to spend another million years on this earth? Do you think we're going to evolve past this altogether, this dimension? What are your thoughts on that?
What is going on is that with these solar flares on which that is coming in, is mutating our DNA and our cellular structure. Please remove that. He's laying on. And what is going on is that with this manifestation of this change or this mutation, we are changing from Homo sapiens sapien to Homo erectus. Not erectus, but Christos, excuse me. Mm-hmm. So we're changing to Homo Christos, which means that we'd be the same as Christ, which is the word Kardes, which means the mummified body of Osiris or Osor, which is talking about the soul, all right? The soul, of course, is embedded inside of the pineal gland, and upon its awakening, based on the connection with the bride, which is the Ascetian energy, which is the Kundalini, he awakens and transforms from Osor to Heru, all right? So changing from the Father to the Son of God, which that symbolizes us transferring from the third eye to the fourth eye, which actually is a galaxy-like cloud on which that hub is over top of the pineal gland. And if you get nutricized by Dr. Layla Africa on page 15, you will see that he has a picture of the brain blown up to the equivalent size of a car. And that galaxy-like cloud is what you build up to once the pineal gland and the intercourse between our set and our saw manifests, which is between the soul and the spirit manifests. All right? So Heru is actually the light, I guess you can say, because Heru means light, is what produces this golden halo or this golden aura around our bodies, in which that does give us a protective shield from lower energies. And the people who have this light can't be touched. All right? In other words, this is supreme consciousness. And with this consciousness, you develop certain siddhas or powers, ESP, extrasensory perceptions, such as you have sight, touch, taste, smell, and hearing. Well, for each one, you have a higher sensory perception in which that correlates to it. For sight, you have clairvoyance. For hearing, you have clairaudience. For taste, you have clairgustance. For smell, you have clairsentience. For touch, you have psychemistry. So these are the gifts in which that you develop. If you want to study more, go to 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, which speaks about the nine fruits of Christ, in which that you have the gift of miracles, gift of healing, gift of speaking in tongues, interpreting tongues, faith, knowledge, wisdom, so forth and so on. And these particular gifts is what you inherit once the Kundalini travels up, this great red dragon travels up through the seven churches, as we would say. So this is the esoteric principles of what's supposed to be happening. And as we get closer to 2012, that spell of Leviathan and Kingle, Willie Lynch, is supposed to be broken. Remember, you really read the Willie Lynch, it says that the spell will last approximately 300 years. That speech was written in 1712. So So 1712 plus 300 equals 2012. So based on the OMAC calendar, it would end that cycle or that eon or that age. We would go from the age of Pisces into the age of Aquarius, all right, which is actually from the age of Sebek into the age of Heru. That's what's going on, all right? And Heru deals with truth. The age of truth is what we're moving into. The age of the gods and goddesses is what we're moving into, where man would be resurrected into his godhood. We would change from a third-dimensional state, go through the dark rift to a fourth-dimensional state, and then on the other side of the dark rift into a fifth-dimensional state. The third dimension deals with length, width, and height. The fourth dimension deals with depth, which is based on time and space. And the fifth dimension deals with light, energy. So we will become more perceptive as we go into 2012. 2012 deals with the galactical alignment of the sun, Alcyon, which sits in the central position of what is called the Milky Way galaxy, which is from the Pleiades, and is hundreds of times larger than our sun. And we're moving, our solar system is moving closer to it. Our galaxy, or solar system, excuse me, is graduating. So we will receive this energy for the first time in 26,000 years. Elijah Muhammad referred to a 25,000-year renewal of history. So it's actually 25,928 years, to be right and exact for you 5%ers. So this is what is going on. This is what is called a Holy Quran. It ain't no goddamn book. The book is a damn testament to what the fuck is going on in space, astrotheology, and what is taking place inside of you, physiology, chemical, alchemy, harmonial, your nervous system, and all of these things are controlled by your breath. Did anybody have to teach anyone how to say Yashu, which is how we sneeze? Did you have a Yashu class as a baby? Everybody make the same goddamn noise or sound when they sneeze. How is that possible? Because that is symbolic to the name, which is the breath of life, which is the name in Aramaic and Hebrew, which is what? Yeshua. So Jesus symbolizes the breath of life, coming from the ancient Kemetic Sumerian word Shu, who is the personification of air. This is how Jesus is within us, and how Jesus is the Savior. And how does Jesus save? He saves us because he saves us from our lower attributes of our lower self and merge it into our higher self so that there's only one self. And that is Allah and man. This is the highest metaphysics you will ever learn on this planet.
Thank you, brother.
We're going to go to the next
caller. Question.
You're welcome. Thank you, brother.
Thank you, Swift Louie. The next one is Sabi Ray.
Greetings, greetings.
Sabir Bey?
Brother Sabir Bey, you on?
Oh, my bad. What's going on, Eileen? Peace. Peace to the sister.
Peace, God. All right, all right.
What's there? What's going on?
Not much. Just trying to open up the eyes, that's all.
You ain't trying, you are. Stop trying.
Right?
Stop cursing at me.
Cursing. I'm just tired of the foolishness, dog. You know, we've been talking about that for years now.
Yeah, we do. Like Nike, just do it. We
right,
did.
Right, no doubt.
Yeah, I didn't get, actually, I just walked out of this building, so I didn't even really, you know, get the what y'all was talking about. What's the, you had a certain subject?
Yeah, the subject was the Washita Moors, the MSTA, and the Islamic connection. I started off breaking down Islam, the word Islam, actually coming from the ancient Kemetic texts. In which that could be verified through several books by Gerald Massey. All of his books speaks about it, in which that ties the word Sharem, S-A-R-E-M, which is the R's and the L's are interchangeable, back to the word Salam, all right, in
okay.
which that is what that the Nile River God Happy bought was Sharem, which is symbolically that particular science, okay?
You know
right,
what? You know what? Liam, I was just listening to the brother. I think he just got off the phone. He was saying something about they put him in a straitjacket. That's real. I've been on the road, actually. I just left Memphis, and I stopped in Chicago. I'm in Detroit now. And I did a and everywhere I've been, it's like people are saying the same thing about they're being put in straitjackets. They're locking them up. They're telling them all these things, right? But people want practical things. And really, I've been telling them, you know, that if we don't have an army, if we're not producing anything, really, they're not going to respect you. I mean, just seeing what I've seen just driving from California, man, and I'm in Detroit getting ready for the second part of this lecture I just did, Hidden Colors, last week. And if anybody on this line have not seen it, I would suggest everybody get Hidden Colors, because that is getting ready to be on some History Channel in a second. And I'm going to tell you, if you have a YouTube, go to YouTube, punch in Hidden Colors. You have one of the brothers at the lecture said, this is one of the top-notch scholars that have all these people in one room. That's like different lectures. You had Francis Cress Welsh, Booker T. Coleman, Phil Valentine, Umar Johnson, which did a dynamite job, my part that was in there, and Brother Tariq. And I'm going to tell you, Brother Aleem, every time I see this film, I almost be getting ready to cry. Dead serious. That a brother that don't deal with nationality created something that people can actually go to, and literally they was thanking him for doing this. So just to see the reaction of people and made it so plain. Now, he produced something that people can grasp and understand and say, wow, we can make some changes. He created a movie. I just wanted to put that out there because we did the screening in Memphis and we did the screening out here in Detroit. So now I'm doing Noble Drolley this Saturday in Detroit. And then I'm shooting to New York. But I'm just saying, man, we got to start producing things because people really, you know, they're saying, so if I come over here, what do you have for me? Can we get a gas station? You know, I'm in Detroit. Shoot, we should have car companies or manufacturing car companies, and we talking about putting tags on our car, on cars, because the cars is not your car. They made the car. So it's like this is why they're locking people up and doing what they're doing, because we're not producing nothing. It's nothing that we're producing. We don't have a newspaper, which is very simple. We don't have no radio station. Blog is cool, but blog is not radio. I did radio for 9 years. It's not radio. We need to have our own radio stations. We need to have our own TV stations. Let's focus our energy on doing those things and backing those type of people who, if they're not doing it themselves, then put up the finances to make it happen. I'm willing to do it to help anybody. I'm willing to do it. If you need my assistance on doing a paper, I did a paper before. If you need my assistance on doing a radio station on how we can do it, we can have seminars on how we can make that happen. That's what we're going to have to compete with these Europeans with, and some of our people, too, because our people want to keep us down, too, because they're comfortable. You know, I didn't really want to come in and take, you know, the floor, but it's just that I know I hear things, man. It's like I said, as I've been traveling, you travel. This is what people crying out for right now. We had a standing room only, man, at this film, and I'm pretty sure it's going to be the same thing with Noble Drolley, because when I've been traveling, they said they have never seen a documentary on Noble Drolley, and we're not done yet. Because we're working on the second part right now. And you're going to be a part of it, too, so I'm coming to get you.
All right, well, I appreciate that, Doc. And yes, we definitely gave out some practical things. First, we had to start with the historical information. I wasn't trying to get too much into procedures. You know, I just wanted to give out practical information as far as the historical connections. We'll definitely get into more of the information. Now, like you said, I will get into this. You know, I know that they've been wanting to do psychological evaluations on individuals, but what I've noticed is that a lot of the psychological evaluations which they want to do on individuals is based on people not actually putting anything on the public record. Mm-hmm. So that is probably one of the problems in which that we are facing. You have to make sure that you put something on the public record. An affidavit has to be put on the public record, and that affidavit must state, you know, specific things such as, are you a 14th Amendment citizen? What is your status, your nationality? What is your connections? What particular tribe? So forth and so on. These things must be stated, and it must be put on record. And then once it's put on record, then if you have any case in which that comes up, if you get any suit, you can put that information into your court case. You go to the criminal division and tell them, look, I got some information I want to enter into the court case. You give them your court case number, and they will put it in. The clerk will put the information in. So then when the DA gets it or when the judge gets it, you defend your information based on the premise, well, have you read the affidavits? If you have not read the affidavits, then we cannot proceed with this matter. And that means that you do not have subject matter because you have not read the subject matter. You do not have person matter because I am not part of the United States based on the fact of the Dred Scott case decision and the 14th Amendment not being fully ratified. So these are the things that we have to learn. We have to learn procedures, all right? Now, of course, you know, only thing they do in courts nowadays is try to litigate and proceed judicially by making you state that you understand what is going on in the courtroom. And if you state that you understand what is taking place, then guess what happens? You are subject to the bond in which they are attaching to your name and to the case. So we have to realize is that these are the things that we have to learn. So that's what I've noticed, all right? I've never gone to jail based on me declaring my nationality and provoking it or evoking it in a court of law, okay? So I can say that for a fact, you know what I'm saying? Now, I've gone to jail based on me having my right, you know what I'm saying, of travel. When I have done my right to travel, all right, now I've been doing the right to travel now basically off and on for the last 6 years, going on 7 years, all right? And based on that premise alone, of course you will have cops who don't know law. They are law enforcement. And law enforcers, but they don't know law. You can get them on, you know, I've done had trials, which I'm not saying that you need to go to trial because you don't. But in the earlier times, we had a trial in which that we actually had the officers on the stand and we asked them specifically about them being law enforcers and if they know law, in particular, constitutional law. And they told us no. Last time they read the Constitution was probably in the 8th grade. And these people was already in their 30s and 40s. So this is the ignorance in which that you're dealing with. All right? So, you know, you just have to do much study. You know what I'm saying? And then you have to learn how to put in countersuits. Countersuits is going to be very necessary. And you state the laws in which that they are violating in your countersuit, your right to travel. Do you know that there's four constitutions? If you're thinking that there was just one constitution, you're sadly mistaken. You have the Articles of Association, Articles of Confederation, the Declaration of Independence, and the Constitution and its Bill of Rights, particularly the first 10. After that, don't apply to us. So you must know these things also, all right? Now, the problem is that the MSTA will tell you that you have to abide by the Constitution, but they're thinking in terms of the divine constitution and bylaws of the temple, but it also states by Prophet Nabi Ali talking about their constitution, because according to their constitution, the treaties, its laws, which is United States Supreme Court case laws and decisions, and the Constitution itself, which are those four constitutions that we just spoke about, are the supreme laws of the land. And in Articles of Confederation, it specifically gives you the ability in order to practice the right to travel. So these are the things that you must know. All right, we're going to get more into the law information as these radio shows goes on. Right now, we just wanted to deal more with the Islamic connections, the MSTA connection with Prophet Nabi Ali, his connection to Washington, and all of these type of connections. So that's what we've been dealing with tonight. And, you know, we're going to get more into what's going on as far as the problems. Because if I get into the Great Schism, you know, that'd be a whole different subject, which I'll spend about another 2 minutes on before we get off. All right, after the death of Prophet Nabi Ali, I won't say who killed him, or who was involved, if he died of pneumonia, tuberculosis, or whatever the case is, according to the death certificate. What I will say is this, is that you had Charles Kirkman Bey, You had John Givenil. You had David Ford Hill, who supposedly have died in 1929. I haven't seen any birth certificate, death certificate of that, but yet it has been stated as such, you know what I'm saying? You know, as well as also E. Milly Hill. Now, Edward Milly Hill, he actually was, according to information, he was the Supreme Grand Sheik. However, during the time in which that Nobodr Ali, prior to him going to jail, for supposedly for the death or participating in the death of Sheik Claude Green, he put or promoted within the place over the temple in which that was David Ford Hill. Now, allegedly, David Ford Hill supposedly died in 1929, but then emerged Master Farah Muhammad. All right? Both in the same area, using the same temple, which was the temple in which that was originally under one of the members of the Moore Science Temple. All right? And that was in Detroit. So these are some odd coincidences, but the debates between the Nation of Islam, the Nation of Gods and Earths, and the Moors has been raving, ranting on for dozens of years. And it seemed that everybody wants to believe that they exist within a vacuum instead of showing the connections. To me, that's linear thinking. That's fragmented thinking. That is not holistic. You want holistic thinking? Then you must master the principles of breathing. All right? Now, you got to understand how all of this correlates. The most practical thing you can do is master the science of breathing. It ain't something that you have to do necessarily outside of yourself. It's something that you have to master within. And then everything goes outside of yourself, manifested from what you have mastered within. People trying to separate the science of breath as if it's something in which that you don't do on an everyday basis or that you don't do 25,000 times a day within a 24-hour span. And this is ridiculous. Practicality, this is practical. Once you build up enough chi, you won't have to worry about negativity because you'll be a force of positivity. You will become the word manifest or the word made flesh. And everything that you say is called ma karu, which basically means that you have the gift of tahuti to speak a thing into existence. So we worry about what's necessarily put on paper. The paper just reflects what you're supposed to be able to say from your mouth in order to manifest what you want into reality. But because you haven't mastered that stage yet, you need paperwork.
Lock you up.
And if you base, and if you're thinking that the paperwork is going to save you, you really have lost your mind. The paperwork can't save you.
But you do need it on
not from this Albion. But it gives him the ability in order to show that you are not just a Negro,
exactly.
That you are growing in intelligence, and that you are definitely one who wants to have self-determination, self-reliance, self-worth, self-love, self-dignity. That's what this is showing. And you're putting it on public record before all. All right? These are the things that you have to overstand first. So we get ready to end this. Oh, okay, we got some questions. All right. Caller 857, excuse me, you're on the line. Caller, you're on the line. 7974, ending in 7974. You're on the line. All right, caller with area code 904, you're on the line. Ending in 0662, you're on the line. Okay. I'm caller, Brother Tim, you're on the line. Brother Tim, you're on the line. You have a question?
Hello?
Yes, greetings.
Yes, greetings, brother. I just had a question about, with regards to Meister versus Moore and how that relates to common law marriage or the marriage license.
All right, well, if you're part of a particular tribe or nation, the actual affidavit can be put together by the person who presided over the marriage ceremony or the wedding. It would be drawn up based on your customs and principles and traditions of the tribe or nation, and then you can go down to the register of deeds and put that on record or have it filed with the civil clerks of the superior court. So either of those two places is where you can actually enter your documentation, they would assign a number to it in which that would show that it's been registered or recorded. Okay? All right, peace. Caller, you're on the line. All right. All right. There's been some talk about some of the information which has been floating around on the internet and different other groups talking about the Ouachita and about how we're not recognized in district court, you know. But remember, these are Article II courts. These are not Article III courts in which that our ancestors went into, such as the King versus United States, such as Henry Turner versus United States and the heirs of Henry Turner versus United States, in which that we've been talking about. Those was actually Article III courts. So these other courts in which that have put forth decisions don't mean nothing to us because they are de facto. So you got Sanders Bay versus the United States, 267F, App, X464. They was making moves. Then you got Baby versus City of Pardubice, 46, F, you know, we got, in which that supposedly finds the nation of Ouachita as fictional. How is it fictional? And I just gave a whole historical damn breakdown of the shit. So, see, this is what happens when you go to crackers who don't know anything about history. Or they're enshrining of Masons or hiding and concealing the facts, and you think that this is actual proof of the concealment. Well, we don't conceal here. I done brought it to you for the last two and a half hours now, breaking down this information, giving you books that you can go and read and study out of. All right, then you got the United States versus Gunwall, 1998, in which that supposedly rejects the claim and have no jurisdiction over a member of the Ouachita as frivolous. Then you got Bay versus Louisiana, July 11, 2008, defining that the plaintiff claim to land as a member of the Ouachita was patently frivolous and rests on documents of dubious legal administration. Now, of course, they can say all of these things based on the fact that if you don't know your historical connections, but it shouldn't matter. You know what I'm saying, if they recognize or not. The truth of the matter still remains, and that's the information which that we've been talking on all night long. The truth of the matter is that the Louisiana Purchase was never purchased, that the land between the Allegheny and the Rockies actually is the land in which that has been proven to belong to the original inhabitants and indigenous people of North America on up into Canada. So when we actually get into this information, you have to realize is that this is what we are building on, you know. So we're going to end it there.
But before that, we just want to break down that we will be in New York at the Harriet Tubman Learning Center July the 31st with New Glory Productions. Shouts out to Brother Olabala and his mate, Sister Elise. The doors are open at 3 o'clock. The event will start at 4:30 promptly, and the admissions are $20. I also want to give a shout-out to the brothers and sisters that are out there, you know, and sincere about this movement. We truly have to do this for the next generation. I don't know how else we can. I just appreciate you, Dr. Aleem El Bey. You're so sincere. You Aries. Sabir Bey, he's going to curse. I mean, what can you expect, you know? But you better believe that he ain't going to steal your money. He ain't going to talk behind your back. And, you know, we're all in this together. We do appreciate what you do, too, as well. Just want to, you know, give a shout-out to all who came on the line. We love and appreciate y'all. We're definitely here for y'all. Please call. You got the numbers earlier. I'll give them to you again. The number is 252-257-3588. Now, this is the home number. This is the landline number. This is what we do, family. I also want to encourage everybody to get Dr. Aleem El Bey's book, The First World Order. We are asking for a contribution of $100 for it, family. If you got a Wii, if you got some Jordans, if you got a PlayStation, then you can definitely invest in your reading. It's an heirloom. It's seen as a composition book, like a college book. If you've never finished your college book, then you'll definitely finish this one. Perfect for the children. Perfect for the family. Plenty of pictures. And as you know, Dr. Aleem El Bey does not hold back with the information. So go to our website. The website is www.cultural-freedom.com. That's CULTURAL-freedom.com. All right, we'll see you next Wednesday. Same time, same place. Peace and love.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air. No doubt.
Right. There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Bird. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. World. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. Order. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Radio. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.